The second lecture is about the ELSV formula. Maybe I should write the names of the authors. Ekedal, Lando, Shapiro, and Weinstein. Okay, so I'll start by writing the formula. It's about the Hurwitz number that I introduced last time, so maybe let me write here a reminder. HG K1 KN. Let me draw the picture that I did last time so that you don't forget what it was. Right, it's the number of ramified coverings of the sphere by a surface of genus G with a fixed ramification profile k1, k2, kn over infinity, and then m, which is equal to 2g minus 2 plus n plus sum of the ki's, simple ramification points. Something like that. So you count the number of branch coverings like that. And this number is equal to m factorial, so this is the ELSV formula, times the product from 1 to n of ki to the power ki over ki factorial, times the integral over the moduli space of stable curves of genus G with n marked points, of the alternating sum of churn classes of the Hodge bundle. There's a lot of words to explain, right? I'm writing the formula, but then I will have to explain all the letters that appear. Divided by 1 minus k1 psi 1, 1 minus kn psi n. Okay, so a large part of this talk will be just explaining all the letters that appear in the right-hand side of this formula. You already know what this number is, and this is the integral of some cohomology class over the moduli space of genus G stable curves with n marked points. So I have to introduce all that. And this will be the our guide. Okay. So first of all, let me introduce the moduli spaces MGN, and then I will add the bar. MGN is the moduli space of genus G Riemann surfaces. Let me call them complex curves. It's the same thing, complex curves with n pairwise distinct marked numbered points. In other words, every point in MGN corresponds to one complex curve of genus G with n marked points. And if two curves are isomorphic, they correspond to the same point of the moduli space. If they are not isomorphic, they correspond to two different points. Okay, so it's best to explain this by examples, so let me give several examples. Yeah, so maybe I'll add one thing on this before it goes too high up. So only defined 4 2 minus 2g minus n negative. That's called the stability condition. In other words, the Euler characteristic of the Riemann surface with n punctures should be negative. You will see why this condition appears. But I write that now because the simplest example is M03. There is no M00, no M01, and no M02. If you take a genus zero Riemann surface, you have to put at least 3 marked points. Okay, so now I claim, I claim that this moduli space is just one point. So why is that? It's because when I take a genus zero Riemann surface with 3 marked points, first of all, a genus zero Riemann surface is always isomorphic to the complex projective line. Moreover, so the complex projective line has a large group of automorphisms, so they are called homographies, I think. All of these. And using this group, there is a unique way to put 3 marked points to 0, 1, and infinity. So you take any genus 0 curve with 3 marked points, it's isomorphic to this in a unique way, if you want to preserve the numbers of the points. So all curves are isomorphic. There is just one point in the moduli space. So let's do M04. OK, M04, it's the same story. You start with a genus 0 curve with 4 marked points. The curve itself is isomorphic to CP1. You can put the 3 first marked points to 0, 1, and infinity. But then there will be the fourth point will go to some t that you cannot control. So all you know is that t is different from 0, 1, and infinity because I told you the points were pairwise distant. And if you start with CP1, t is actually the cross ratio of these 4 numbers. So let me try to write it down correctly. If I want to get t starting from this, I have to divide t minus 0 by 1 minus 0, right? So it would be x4 minus x1 divided by x2 minus x1, and all that divided by x4 minus x3 over x2 minus x3. That's the cross ratio of x1, x2, x3, x4. That's how you find t. Okay, so that means that M04 is isomorphic to CP1 minus 3 points. T is the coordinate on M04. Right? If you know t, you know your curve up to isomorphism, and t can be any point of CP1 except 0, 1, and infinity. Yes? Just a point with a, so you just have a Riemann surface and some points are marked and they have some numbers. Okay? That's a so this is a genus zero curve with 4 marked points. X1, X2, X3, X4. And I claim that it is isomorphic to CP1 with markings at 0, 1, infinity, and t. And t determines the complex structure of the curve, the positions of the points. OK, so similarly, now I can do M0n. So if you have n points, it's the same story again. The curve is isomorphic to CP1. You can put 3 points to 0, 1, and infinity. And then you will have n minus 3 remaining points in CP1 such that Ti is different from Tj and Ti is different from 0, 1, and infinity. So M0n is a complex manifold, non-compact complex manifold of dimension n minus 3. And it's actually a complement, the complement of a hyperplane arrangement. If you remove the infinities, you can replace CP1 by C. It's a complement of some hyperplane arrangement. So it's a okay, so now let me do M11. Now again, the stability condition forbids me to do M10. If the genus is 1, there should be at least one marked point. Let's do M11. So we have to classify all elliptic curves, genus 1 curves, with one marked point. So every elliptic curve is isomorphic to C factored by a lattice of parallelograms. So L is a lattice like that. It's a discrete additive subgroup of C isomorphic to Z2. And the picture explains it in a much better way. So if you take C and you factor it by a lattice of parallelograms, you get a torus, because so this is the fundamental domain. And if you glue the left side to the right side and the bottom side to the top side, you get a torus. And the image of the lattice itself is the marked point. Okay, so every elliptic curve can be represented like that. But now, if there are two lattices, sometimes they give isomorphic elliptic curves. So when is, so if I have two lattices, L1 and L2, when are they equivalent? When do they lead to isomorphic elliptic curves? The answer is very simple. It's when one is proportional to the other. So when there is a non-zero complex number by which you can multiply one lattice to give you another lattice. You take this lattice, you multiply it by a non-zero complex number, you get another lattice. Obviously, the two elliptic curves are isomorphic, and that's the only case. So there is the first answer, which is correct, but it can be made more explicit, so I will continue. But the first answer is that M11 is the set of lattices factored by C star. But we actually can do a little bit better than that. So in order to do better than that, let me choose a basis, a direct basis of the lattice. So I will erase the fundamental domain, just keep the lattice. Okay, here's a direct basis. Right, I draw it in a strange way so that you see that the choice is not unique. There are many choices, and we will have to pay for that in a moment. Okay, so then if you have a basis like that, you can choose your non-zero complex number in such a way that the first vector goes to 1. So you divide both vectors by the first one. And then you get the basis 1 tau, where tau belongs to the upper half plane. Because it was a direct basis, so the second vector will be in the upper half plane. 1 tau. Okay. But now there is, okay, but now we can change, we can choose another basis, so we should factor this by the group of basis changes, and this group is SL2Z that transforms tau into A tau plus B over C tau plus D. So ABCD now is an integer matrix with determinant equal to 1. That's the that corresponds to other choices of direct basis. For instance, we can replace tau by tau minus 1. And these two are, right, these are two bases of the same lattice. So So this group SL2Z has a fundamental domain. I'm sure that you have all seen this picture one day or another. So if you draw the unit circle and two vertical lines, so this is minus 1, 0, 1, minus 1 half, and 1 half. So this thing here is a fundamental domain for SL2Z. Now, to obtain the moduli space, you have to glue the left side to the right side, and this arc to this arc. And you will obtain some kind of a semi-infinite bag, something like that. That goes to infinity. This is M11. So what you can see here is that it is no longer a manifold. Remember, M0n was a smooth complex manifold. Not compact, but still a smooth complex manifold. This thing is again non-compact. There is clearly one point missing at infinity. But moreover, you can see that there are special points. These two special points where the, well, it's not a manifold. So this is called an orbifold. And that means that the neighborhood of every point, so neighborhood of every point is an open ball divided by a finite group. And actually, I can be more specific in the case of moduli spaces. So if I take a point P in MGN, this finite group is actually the group of automorphisms of the corresponding curve CP. So let's see how that works out for M11. Let's do this example and see all the, classify all the automorphism groups of elliptic curves. Okay, so if I take a generic lattice of parallelograms, so this is 0, okay, so if I take a generic lattice of parallelograms, it has the group of automorphisms is Z over 2Z because I have the central symmetry, and that's all there is. Right? The only automorphism of this lattice is plus or minus identity on the complex plane. So a generic elliptic curve has exactly two automorphisms. It can be called the hyperelliptic automorphism, even though for an elliptic curve, maybe hyper is not necessary. Okay, and indeed, if I take a generic point in the moduli space, so its neighborhood is a disk, but this is not just any disk, it's a disk with a trivial action of Z2, actually. Because if you look at the stabilizer of this point in SL2Z, remember I wrote that the moduli space was H over SL2Z. So sometimes people write PSL2Z, but the correct structure is actually to factor it by SL2Z. In that case, so SL2Z in particular contains the matrix minus identity, minus 1, minus 1, 0, 0, that acts trivially. There is still this formula. If you plug the minus identity matrix, you see that tau goes to tau, right? So for a generic point, there is this trivial, I mean, the stabilizer of this point in SL2Z is plus or minus identity. So the neighborhood of this point is this disk endowed with a trivial action of z over to z. It's the quotient of a disk by a trivial action of z over to z. That's part of the orbifold structure.
Why do you say the correct structure is the quotient by S L T Z and not P S L T
Z? That's the definition of the, if you define moduli spaces properly as Dilling-Mumford's text, for instance, if I'm going to compute integrals of characteristic classes over the space, it will be important. It will change the answer, and the answer that you get, you will see. You could define both structures, but if you want to get coherent answers for different G's and N's, this is much nicer. Okay, so let's look at this point now. So this point corresponds to the square lattice, all right? The basis is 1 and I. So here we have the square lattice like that. And this has a group of automorphisms, so this is 0. This has a group of automorphisms, z over 4z, 4 rotations. And if we look at the neighborhood of this point, it's this disk factored by the z over 4z action. But the z over 4z has a z over 2z inside it that still acts trivially. Right? So actually, you really factor only by z over 2z, which is why you see half a disk here. Yes?
So by acting trivially, what happens is that points that are close to our point in the ball are other curves, and the automorphism of this curve goes to another
one. Yes, yes, exactly. So this curve has more automorphisms, but one of them, right, the minus one is preserved for all the neighborhoods. So yes. And the same thing happens here. So here it's the sixth root of unity, right? It's the lattice spanned by one and the sixth root of unity. So it's the hexagonal lattice. Like that. Its group of automorphisms is z over 6z. And again, out of these six automorphisms, there is one which is preserved. So actually, if you look at the neighborhood of this point, so this is a disk. This is actually two times the same point. So you have 1/6 of a turn here, 1/6 of a turn here. So altogether, you have an angle of 2 pi over 3. Even though the group is z over 6z, but one element acts, two elements act trivially, so the angle you get is 2 pi over 3. Okay. So now I have to add the bar. All these spaces are very nice, but they are not compact. And it would be good to construct a nice compactification. So that is called the Dilling-Mumford compactification. Maybe I will not even need this blackboard. Dilling-Mumford compactification. No, I will. Okay, I will write it down. So MGN bar is the space of stable curves of genus G with unmarked points. So I have to define what is a stable curve, right? Let me make a picture. So a stable curve is a curve with one type of singularities allowed, namely simple self-intersections. So stable curves can be singular, but there is only one type of singularity allowed. That's the simple self-intersection, like x times y equals 0. Unfortunately, in my pictures, these simple self-intersections look like tangences because I cannot do otherwise. But this is not a tangency, this is a simple self-intersection. Algebraic geometers often draw them like that, but I prefer to show the genus. So if you draw it like that, it's hard to show the genus of the components. So you have to compromise in some way. So the only allowed singularities are simple self-intersections. Yeah, let me write that down. Only simple self-intersections allowed. Then there's the condition that the marked points, so you still have n marked points, 1 to n, the marked points are still distinct and smooth. So they are not allowed to collide, and they are not allowed to collide with the nodes. Yes?
So the definition of MGM, it was non-singular
curves? These were smooth curves, yes. maybe I should add that. Yes, thank you. Okay, so the marked points are distant and smooth, and then there is the stability condition, the last condition that is called the stability, which can be formulated in different ways. So let me write two definitions. The first definition is that the automorphism group of C is finite. So this is necessary if we want to get a nice orbifold. You see in this orbifold, the neighborhood of any point is a ball factored by a finite group. If you start factoring by infinite groups, you get much, well, the spaces that you get are not as nice at all. So this is a necessary condition. This also explains why I had to impose that 2 minus 2g minus n was negative. If you take, for example, an elliptic curve without marked points, it has an infinite group of automorphism by translations, right? And same thing for CP1. If you take CP1 and only mark 0 and infinity, 2 marked points, you have a C star group of automorphisms. And so a simpler way to check this condition is that 2 minus 2g I minus ni is negative for every component I. So if you take any component of the curve, you take the normalization. Okay, let me say it like that. You take your curve and you remove all nodes and all marked points with a small needle. You remove all the self-intersections and all the marked points. So what you get is a non-connected curve, disconnected curve with some punctures. And the Euler characteristic of every connected component should be negative. So for instance, if I draw this is not stable. This is still not stable. And this is stable. And more interesting example, okay, I'll do that when we we're going to do these examples. So I'll show you what what happens. Okay. So let's see what happens if you add the bar to these spaces. So M03 is already compact. M03 bar is again one marked point. You don't add anything. Okay, M04 bar. I think you probably expect what it's going to be if M04 is CP1 without 3 points, yes.
So the NI counting both the marked points and the nodes?
Yes, NI counts all punctures, yes. So this, as you see, there is one puncture here and two punctures here, so this is stable. Okay, so if M04 was CP1 with three punctures, you can guess that M04 is going to be CP1, right? So the interesting part is what stable curves correspond to these three extra marked points that we added. So there are three non-smooth stable curves. So let me draw these stable curves. Here they are. One is 1, 2, 3, 4. One, 3, 2, 4. And 1, 4, 2, 3. Right, so there are three ways to split four markings into two pairs, and these correspond to these singular curves. So if you want to have a a stable curve, every component of the curve should have two markings, otherwise it's not stable. So you have to split them into pairs. And I will draw one more picture to convince you that it is possible to... So at first sight, it seems rather strange that when you have just one rational curve, one genus zero curve, it is rather strange that in the limit it can tend to a curve composed of two reducible components. Right. So let me show you how that happens. This is just the family xy equals epsilon. So this is a family of curves on the plane. When epsilon is non-zero, this is a rational curve. Right? This is a smaller epsilon, but still non-zero, and it's still a rational curve. And on all these curves, I can mark four points like that. x1, x2, x3, x4. Right? And now see what happens when epsilon becomes zero. The curve is now composed of two axes, so it's two rational curves with a simple self-intersections with two markings on one component and two markings on the other component. So this is exactly the picture of the universal curve over at the neighborhood of a node. Okay, and let me also do this. So M1, 1 bar. As I said, there is one missing point at infinity. So in the compactification, you add this one point. So maybe I should draw it in a more round way, like that, because this is a smooth point. It's not at all a Norberfold point. It's a point like everything else. So this point, this extra point, corresponds to the unique stable curve that you can, like that. So that's a pinched torus. This is an important remark. So this is a stable curve, right? It is obtained by, so you take CP1 with three markings, 0, infinity, and 1, and you glue 0 and infinity together, right? And this is a this is a genus 1, the only stable curve of genus 1 that is not smooth. And the group of automorphisms of this curve is composed of two elements, 1 and 1 over z. So 1 over z exchanges 0 and infinity. When I was talking about genus 0 curves with 3 marked points, there was no automorphisms because the points were numbered. But now 0 and infinity are not numbered anymore. They are just 2 branches at this node. So there is 1 automorphism that extends, that exchanges the 2 branches at this node. So this point is like every other point. It has a disk with a trivial action of z over 2z. And topologically, this is just a sphere, homeomorphic to a sphere. Okay. So now I have prepared a picture of MGN bar. Okay, so this is my picture of MGN bar. It is a smooth, complex, compact orbifold of complex dimension 3g minus 3 plus n. And each of its points represents a stable curve of genus g with n marked points. So in this case, I took genus 2 and 3 markings. If you take a generic point, it corresponds to a smooth genus g curve with n marked points. But then inside MGN, there is a normal crossing divisor. So this is a subvariety of codimension 1 with normal crossings. That means that the intersections are like the walls and the floor of this room. And these are the things that we added during the compactification. So this is not a boundary in the sense of manifolds with boundary. It's the things that we added under the compactification. If you remove this white thing, you get MGN. And the points here correspond to curves with non-smooth curves with simple self-intersections. So there are 2 kinds of nodes. This is a node. This node is separating because this node separates the curve into 2 irreducible components. And there are actually many types of nodes like that. I represented here only 1 component, but there are many more because the genus can split into 1-1 or 2-0 or 0-2 or 2-0, and the marked points can be distributed in different ways among the components. And then there is 1 special component that's the component of non-separating nodes. So this node is non-separating. If you normalize the node, the curve remains connected. And then there are intersections of these components. So this is a deeper boundary point at the intersection. So here you have 2 nodes, 1 separating and 1 non-separating. And here you have 2 non-separating nodes. And so on. If I could draw pictures in 3 dimensions, there are even deeper intersections with 3 nodes and so on. Okay. So this, so far I have covered MGN bar. Now I have to introduce the psis and lambdas. So the psis and lambdas are characteristic classes on MGN bar, Chern classes of some vector bundles and line bundles. So let me first introduce the line bundles and vector bundles, and then the Chern classes. Okay, so first of all, let me introduce the line bundle L1. So I take the first marked point on all of my curves, and I draw the cotangent complex line to this marked point. On my picture, it probably looks more like a tangent, but the standard convention is to take the cotangent line. So you see there is a complex line hanging over every point of MGN bar. Right? You take a point of MGN bar, there is the curve, there is the first marked point on the curve, and they can take the cotangent complex line. So that's a line bundle L1 over MGN bar. Complex line bundle. A complex line hanging over each point of MGN bar. And since I have n marked points, there are n line bundles, L1, Ln. Okay, so for those who know about Chern classes, so I suspect that usually I assume people know what are Chern classes, but I suspect that since it's a conference on combinatorics, I decided to spend some time to introduce them. But before doing that, let me just say that psi I is the first Chern class of the line bundle Li. It lies in the second cohomology group of MGN bar. So I will spend a couple of minutes explaining that. But if you know about first Chern classes, you'll be fine with this. And before talking about Chern classes, there is one more vector bundle. This is called the Hodge bundle. Hodge bundle. Okay, and so if you take a point P in the moduli space, the fiber EP is composed of holomorphic differential one forms on the curve CP. So this vector bundle does not depend on the marked points. You can define it without any marked points. Okay, if you take a point in MGN bar, you have your Riemann surface of genus G. On this genus G surface, there is a G-dimensional space of holomorphic one forms. Right, so if you know something about Riemann surfaces, you certainly know this in particular. On the genus G Riemann surface, there is a G-dimensional space of holomorphic one forms. So they form a G-dimensional vector space that is called EP, and these G-dimensional vector spaces form a rank G vector bundle. Which bundle, so its rank is equal to G. And lambda I is the ith Chern class of the Hodge bundle. So this lies in H2I of MGN bar. So now, in principle, I have defined the psi classes and the lambda classes. So I have defined all the letters that appear in the in the ELSE formula. Let me spend a couple of minutes on Chern classes. Oh, the other one is still invisible, right? No, this is not. Okay. Yes. Yes.
Is the signature psi i close to the classical
density. Equal to, sorry, did I write? Equal to, oh, sorry. It's okay, yeah, because the other. Psi I equals the first term plus of Li. To be moved all the way up there.
Li is at marked point pi, right?
Li is the cotangent line at the marked point number I, yes. Okay, so 7 minutes on the first, yes. Yes, holomorphic at the marked points. There is something to do at the nodes, but I think I will skip that for today. There is, you have to extend your definition properly when the curve is singular. But for smooth curves, it's just a holomorphic one form on the curve. Okay, so I'll give you two definitions. Okay, so let me do the, okay. 5 minutes to define the first turn class of a line bundle over CP1. So this is a complex line bundle. Okay, so there is one definition that comes from algebraic geometry, which is just take a meromorphic section S of L. And then the first turn class of L, it's the number of its zeros minus the number of its poles. Both the zeros and the poles should be counted with multiplicity. So if you have a zero of order 3, you should count it 3 times. And this thing does not depend on the section and gives you an invariant of the line bundle. Right? So that's a very practical definition if you can construct a section. But it hides the nature of the first turn class, because actually it's a completely topological invariant. So now let me take, okay, this CP1. Let me take an S1 bundle, oriented S1 bundle. So if you have a complex line bundle, you can construct one thing. You can construct an oriented S1 bundle just by removing the zero and factoring by R plus. Right, so to go from here to here, you take L minus the zero section divided by R plus. Yes?
Can you recall what a section?
A meromorphic section of a line bundle. So a section assigns a point. So it's a way to find a point. A section is like that.
Okay.
So to every point of the base, you assign a point on the fiber, and it should be meromorphic. Okay, so if you have your complex line bundles, you remove the zero section and you factor every fiber by R plus, you obtain an S1 bundle that is naturally oriented because the complex line has an orientation, right? Okay, so now you cut your CP1, your sphere, into two half spheres. Right, the north and the south half sphere, and since a half sphere is contractible to a point, so the circle bundle is x over this half sphere. So I don't know, north and south is isomorphic to just the trivial circle bundle. And this is isomorphic to the trivial, say, yeah, I have to write it. Right, north times S1 and south times S1. So both half spheres are contractible, so you can trivialize any any bundle. Okay. So now let's look at the equator. On the equator, you can take the north trivialization times some base point, times the point one in the circle. Right, you have your circle, this is the point one. And you have the south trivialization. But they are not the same. So if you go around the equator, you will see that the north trivialization makes several turns around the south trivialization. Right? So on the equator, you go along the equator, you have your circles, and on this circle you have one point that comes from the north and one point that comes from the south. And they don't know about each other, so one point with respect to the other makes several turns. So the first turn class of x is the number of turns of south with respect to north. Along the equator. Okay, so now what's the relationship between these two definitions? They look completely different. Here you count zeros and poles, and here you do some topological invariant of your circles counting the turns. So the relation comes from the theorem from complex analysis 1. So if you have a holomorphic function defined in some domain and you want to count its zeros and meromorphic function defined in some domain and you want to count its zeros and poles. So you look at f prime of z divided by f of z, and you can easily see that this is holomorphic everywhere where f has no zeros and no poles. And if it has a zero or a pole, this thing has always a simple pole, and the residue is equal to the order of the zero or minus the order of the pole. Right? And when you integrate this to compute the sum of residues, which is exactly the sum of zeros and so counting zeros and poles with their orders, so this is the integral of d logarithm of f. So you actually, the logarithm of f, you just count the number of turns that f of z makes around zero, right? You are following gamma, you are looking at, so z follows gamma, f of z makes several turns around zero, and you just count these turns, right? And the number of turns gives you the number of zeros minus the number of poles inside this domain. Right, so this is, this connects the two definitions. You can see how. Okay. So this was the definition of the first turn class over CP1, which is just a number. But in general, it is not a number, it's a two cohomology class. So if you have a complex manifold of higher dimension, actually even a real manifold, you can define it for oriented circle bundles. You can restrict this definition to any two-dimensional surface. So it works in the same way. I did it for CP1, but it works in the same way for any compact surface. So the first turn class actually assigns a number to any compact surface, to any two homology class. If you have a surface, it represents a two homology class. And the first turn class is in a two cohomology. It assigns a number to every homology class. Okay. Or another way to say the same thing, if you have a section, so if you have a higher dimensional manifold here, the zeros and poles of your section form a divisor, codimension one subvariety. So by Poincaré duality, it represents a two cohomology class. Okay. So I think we are ready to look back at the ELSV formula. Just one more thing. When I write 1 minus k psi, that means 1 plus ki psi I plus ki squared psi I squared plus and so on.
Question?
Yes.
If I take 1 over s, don't I get minus the result?
If you take 1 over S, it's not a section of L, it's a section of the dual line bundle of L. And the first turn class is opposite of L. So you are perfectly right. Which number, sorry?
I mean, is this first chain class?
What this number measures? Well, so I don't know. Here I have two definitions that both explain it in some way, right? The number of zeros minus how twisted it is. So the trivial line bundle, if you just take CP1 times C, has first turn class equal to 0. If you take, for instance, let's take the cotangent. So the cotangent line bundle to CP1, it has a section DZ. Right? DZ has no zeros and no poles in the finite part. But then if you look at infinity, so you have to make the change of variables W equals 1 over Z. Or maybe it's better to write z equals 1 over w. So d of 1 over w is equal to minus 1 over w squared dw. So this section has a double pole at infinity. Right? So the first turn class of this is equal to minus 2. Right? You can see it's not a trivial line bundle. It has... Okay. So, okay, let me give one example of so first of all, let's go back to this formula and make sure that we understand everything. So on the left-hand side, you have your Hurwitz number, yeah, almost everything. I didn't define higher turn classes, so that will be some cohomology classes, and that's enough for today. Yes.
Sorry, I'm a bit confused because sometimes you're defining bundles over a curve, and sometimes over n, g, n.
Yes. So. So Li is a line bundle over the over MgN bar. So psi I is a cohomology class of MgN bar. But it is also possible when you have a curve, it is also possible to define a line bundle over a curve, and then the first turn class will be in the cohomology of this curve.
Can I go back to your definition in terms of section? So you would
yes. I would have to find a section. Okay, so let me. So this I was actually hesitating whether I do that or not because I'm okay. Let's try to okay, let's try to look at M04 bar. we try to compute psi 1. So we have to construct a section of L1. So what does it mean constructing a section of L1? It means that for any curve, genus 0 curve with 4 marked points, 1, 2, 3, 4, I have to find a cotangent vector at the first marked points. So how I do that? I will do it in the following way. I will decide that x2 goes to 0. x3 goes to infinity, and then I will write the holomorphic one-form dz over z taken at x1. In more intrinsic terms, on this rational curve, there's a unique meromorphic one-form with poles at points number 2 and 3. Let me write x1, x2, x, okay. I'll make this picture a little bit larger so that everything is. So here is x1, x2, x3, and x4. This is a rational curve, right? A sphere, CP1. There's a unique meromorphic one form on the CP1 that has a residue equal to 1 at x2 and a residue equal to minus 1 at x3. So the way to construct this meromorphic one form is to put x0 at 0, x2 at 0, x3 at infinity, choose a global coordinate so that 0 is here and infinity is here, and take this meromorphic one form. You can see that if you multiply z by c star, it doesn't change. So that's an invariant choice. There is exactly really one unique meromorphic one form here. And then I take its restriction to x1, and that gives me some cotangent vector. I draw it as a tangent vector, but actually a cotangent vector at x1. The restriction of this form to x1. Right? So now to every curve I have associated, so given a curve, I have found a cotangent vector at x1. That's a section of L1. Right? Okay, so now I have to determine its zeros and poles. So as you see, this thing does not vanish anywhere. So it has poles at x2 and x3, but x1 is not equal to x2 and x3. So it doesn't have any poles. It doesn't seem to vanish anywhere. But actually, there is exactly one point where it vanishes. And it's the point here. So if you have x2 and x3 here, and x1 and x4 here, then your meromorphic one form, well, it, on this component, it will still be dz over z, as before. But on this component, it is identically equal to 0. So at this point of the moduli space, the point that we added under the compactification, this section will have a simple 0. You have to check it in local coordinates, but it's going to be a simple 0. On the other hand, if I take a point like that, x2, x1, x4, and x3. So here I will have dz over z on this component and dz over z on this component. So I will have simple poles here, a simple pole at the node with opposite residues, and a simple pole here. So for this, I would need to explain how to extend the notion of differentials to stable curves. So at some point, you ask me the question, when you define a holomorphic differential on a stable curve, you have to allow poles with opposite residues at the nodes. So in this case, you have something that is non-zero, and the cotangent vector here is non-zero. So this is not a vanishing and not a pole. So in the end, this thing is equal to 1. There is exactly one point where this section vanishes. I suspect this is a little bit too hard for an oral presentation, but I can repeat it once again. It may be a little bit confusing. But we have constructed a section. So as you see, this section of L1, it's really a section over M0 4 bar. It's not a section over a curve. Yes?
So when you say that L1 is 1, what does it mean to integrate?
Okay, so in this case, it's actually Poincaré dual to the class of the point. It's a two cohomology class. So M04 is a sphere, right? A two cohomology class. When you integrate a two cohomology class over a sphere, you get the number. This is the number 1. But if your M04, so if you take M05, for instance, it would be two dimensional, I mean, complex dimension 2, real dimension 4. So psi class would be a two cohomology class. And then you have to multiply two of them in order to integrate. So you have relations like M04. So the integral of psi 1 over M04 bar equals 1. But when you go to M05 bar, you can write psi 1 squared. So that's 1. Or you can write psi 1 psi 2. That's 2. I know the answers by heart, but you can find them. If you go to M06, you would need 3 of them, and so on. Okay, so what do we see here? We see some cohomology class That is not cohomogeneous. This is a zero cohomology class, two cohomology class, four cohomology class, and so on. So this thing is also a cohomology class that is not homogeneous, has different parts. So we have n plus one factors, one factor in the numerator and the other ones that are in the denominator, but actually they mean just this. So we take the product of these n plus one factors and we extract the terms of degree 2 times the complex dimension of mg n bar. So 2 times 3g minus 3 plus n. And these are the terms that you can integrate over mg n bar. And you get some number. Right, so let's apply the LSE formula in the case g equals 1, n equals 1. So M11 bar, remember I made a picture, it's something like that. So it's homeomorphic to a sphere. This is important because it means that we will be interested in two cohomology classes. When you integrate some cohomology class on the sphere, if you want to get a number, it has to be of cohomological degree 2. So what does the formula say? Okay, so first of all, I will have the numbers h1k. So the number of ways to represent a k-cycle as a product of k plus 1 transpositions. If you take genus 0, so k means you have the permutation that you want to represent as a product of transpositions is a k-cycle. In genus 0, you have the minimal number of transpositions, which is k minus 1. In genus 1, you add 2 more transpositions. So you want to count the number of ways to represent a k-cycle as a product of k plus 1 transpositions. And the ELSV formula, yeah, and also M, so it's equal to 2g minus 2 plus n plus sum of the ki's. So in this case, 2g minus 2 is 0, n is 1, so that's k plus 1, right? So the ELSV formula says that this number is equal to k plus 1 factorial times k to the power k over k factorial times the integral over M11 bar of 1 minus lambda 1 divided by 1 minus k psi 1. So let me transform this, just rewrite it so integral over M11 bar of 1 minus lambda 1. And as I told you, this is actually 1 plus k psi. And I could go further, but it's not necessary because this is homeomorphic to a sphere. Psi squared is a cohomology class of degree 4. It already vanishes. So I can stop here. OK, and out of this product, I must extract the terms of cohomological degree 2 in order to integrate them over my sphere. So what I get is just 2 terms, k psi, psi 1 maybe, yeah, psi 1, minus lambda 1. Let me write another integral here. Okay, so in spite of my brilliant introduction to moduli spaces, maybe, okay, and I'll even, okay, write it like that. Even better. Okay, so now in spite of my brilliant introduction to moduli spaces, I think unless you know already, you are still not able to compute these two integrals. Right? So let's denote them by x and y. These are two unknown quantities. Now you see, instead of a series of unknown numbers, Hurwitz numbers, there's a different Hurwitz number for any k. Now we only have two unknown quantities to determine. So to determine two unknown quantities, that's easy. We can compute our Hurwitz numbers in two examples. So let's compute h11 and h12. Okay, h11 is the number of ramified coverings of the sphere by a torus of total degree 1. This is just not possible. If you have a covering of the sphere of degree 1, it has to be a covering by a sphere. So this number is equal to 0. Which means that if I plug k equals 1, I should get 0. So I get the first equation, x equals y. Right, if I plug k equals 1, this thing should be equal to 0. So k, so x minus y is equal to 0, x equals y. Okay, now let's do h12. h12 was actually one of my examples from last time. It's the number of ways to represent a transposition as a product of three transpositions. There is exactly one way to do that, and in addition, this covering has a group of two automorphisms. So this number is equal to 1/2. That's one of the examples from yesterday. So we get a second equation. Okay, for the second equation, I have to compute all this. So 3 factorial times 2 squared over 2 factorial times 2x minus y is equal to 1/2. Okay, so this is, okay, so this means 2x minus y is equal to 1 over 24. Right, 3 factorial over 2 factorial is 3, 3 times 4 is 12, and times 2 is 24. Okay, so this system is easy to solve. You get x equals y equals 1 over 24. So if I have 5 minutes in the end, I will show you that this answer is actually related to modular forms. If you want to compute these intersection numbers without using the LSV formula, just from geometry, you can use modular forms. But this is the correct answer, and it's a fraction. Usually when you have churn classes, you just count zeros and poles, so usually you get integers. But on an orbifold, you can get a fractional number, because different zeros and poles can count with a weight 1 over the automorphism group, so zeros and poles can come with fractional weights. And this also answers your question why this is the correct structure. Right? We want to get this answer from geometry. Okay, so now we have the final answer. So first of all, we have computed these two numbers. That's one result. And the other result is that we know h1k. So this is now, okay, so it's something like k to the power k, k squared minus 1 divided by 24. So I simplified k plus 1 factorial and k factorial to get k plus 1. And here I also get k minus 1. So that gave me k squared minus 1. Right, both results are quite non-trivial. I mean, if you want to prove this formula without using ELSV, it's not simple at all. Count the number of ways to represent a k-cycle as a product of k plus 1 transpositions, especially you don't see at all how you would get this divided by 24, right? So this shows that it's not a trivial formula. is there another way to find this formula? You mean from the geometry of from combinatorics or from?
No, from geometry of moduli
spaces. Oh, the to find this then, or to find what? So this is about Hurwitz numbers. To find this combinatorial. So let me think. I think. Yes, it's a good question. So there are ways, because now there are proofs of, I mean, the Bouchard-Marigny conjecture, for example, gives you this too. Now there is a proof independent from the ELSV formula. So the answer is there is a way to do that, but it's extremely complicated. So if you're asking if there's a simpler way, I'm not sure. Probably if you give me this as a challenge, it should be doable.
You don't get it from the equation you showed us yesterday?
From the cut and join equation?
Yeah.
No, you don't get it from the cut and join equation. This is, no, this is...
You get it easily from the representation theory, because since you have a long cycle, you have only hooks in the expansion. And
yes.
You can compute everything explicitly, relative easily, I mean, for this case. And you can also do it by hand.
I see. Yeah, so yeah, this will definitely work. Yes, thank you. So there, In general, for any genus, yeah, when you have one cycle that you have, you can get a final. Yes, thank you. Okay, so there is another way that is right. Okay. So now I have a dilemma, because I can either give you an idea of how this formula is proved. Let me try to do this. I think this is perhaps more and more important. It will be mostly hand waving. So the proof of the formula uses what is called the space of stable maps to CP1. Stable maps to CP1 with poles of orders K1, Kn. So as I told, so when I draw these pictures, right, when we enumerate ramified coverings, this thing is a map from a Riemann surface to CP1. To CP1. With poles of orders K1, Kn. And I can consider the space of all maps like that, all possible Riemann surfaces and all possible maps like that. And this space, just as the moduli space of curves itself, is not compact. So we have to compactify it by adding stable maps. Stable maps are somewhat similar to stable curves, so that means that this surface here can have simple self-intersections, and moreover that the number of automorphisms of this curve that commute with the map is finite. So the funny part about stable maps is that you can have contracted components, something like that. This is a singular curve with a simple self-intersection, and one of the components has some meromorphic function with poles, but on this component the meromorphic function is just constant. And this is perfectly allowed as long as this curve has a finite number of automorphisms. So you usually get this when several branch points start colliding together. If you have several branch points that collide together, sometimes you will have to compactify your space by adding contracted components like that. They may also meet the curve at several points. Something like that. Okay, and so now we take the space of stable maps. Let me write it here. Can denote it like that, the space of stable maps to CP1 with poles of order k1, kn. And from this space, there is a morphism that I call a branching morphism to the mth symmetric power of C. So when you have one stable map, it has some branch points here, m of them. And there is a construction that extends this count to contracted components. So when you have a contracted component, the image of this contracted component is counted as a branch point of some prescribed multiplicity. So there is a natural way to assign a multiplicity to every picture like that, so that the branching morphism is extended smoothly. And we would like to find the degree of this branching morphism. So there are two ways to do that. One way is to compute the degree at the most generic point, where all branch points are distant from each other. And in this case, this degree is just the Hurwitz number. This is exactly, you count the ramified coverings with prescribed poles, prescribed branch points. That's exactly the problem that the Hurwitz number answers. Right? So if you take the most generic point, the degree of this branching morphism is the Hurwitz number. But then you can also do what people in algebraic geometry usually do. Instead of taking the generic point, you take the most degenerate point. You take all your branch points, all m of them, and you put them all at zero. So now you have to count a branch covering that has a given ramification over infinity and no ramification at all, except that something is allowed to happen over zero. So how is this possible? There's only one possibility. You should have a contracted curve of genus G over zero, and then some rational components, and here you have the map z to the power k1, z to the power k2, z to the power kn. Right, so you have the poles of correct multiplicities. These are simple self-intersections, and the map z to the power k has no branch points. There are no ramifications outside of zero and infinity. Okay. And so this point has the preimage of this point under the branching morphism is MGN bar, because now here you have a stable curve of genus G with unmarked points. So it's a map with infinite fibers. I don't know if you know examples of this. It's a map that is finite, that has a finite degree, but that still has infinite fibers. So an example of the simplest example of that is a blow up. If you take so take the space of all lines that go through zero, right? Not just the space of lines, but the space of points of every line. So it's the tautological line bundle over CP1. CP1 is the space of lines through the origin, but now you take the actual lines, right? And you see that every point in C2 is covered once, but the origin has an infinite fiber isomorphic to CP1. Right? So if you take CP1 and you take the tautological line bundle, the full space of the tautological line bundle, you can map this to C2. And it's a morphism, it's a map of degree one, but over zero it has an infinite fiber CP1, and this is called the blow up at zero. So something similar happens here. This is the branching morphism is of finite degree, but sometimes it has infinite fibers. And now how do we find the degree? We're looking at an infinite fiber. How do you find a degree? So in algebraic geometry, there is a way to do that. You have to look at the normal vector bundle, take its Segre class. So there's a machinery that does that. And you find an integral over mg n bar of some characteristic class, which is exactly what the ELSP formula tells you. So if you apply the if you apply the method to find the degree from looking at an infinite fiber, you find this formula. OK, so I think I will stop here. That's perfect. Thank you.